العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
أخر أجله بوجه الله الليل والله يسمعني حتى بلغه 60 سنة. And Allah allowed you to live for 60 years, you have no excuse anymore. إقامة الحجة عليك, the proof has been established against you. If you reach age of 60, there's no longer any excuse for you, because Allah has given you enough time for you to repent, enough time for you to come back, and enough time for you to choose the best path. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us in a hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لَيَعْجَبُ. Allah is fascinated. It amazes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مِنَ الشَّابِ لَيْسَتْ لَهُ صَبْوَةً. A youth that doesn't have any faults or errors. A youth that the desires of doing haram has been taken away from him. Allah is fascinated with a youth is like this. Ponder over this hadith. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لَيَعْجَبُ. Allah is fascinated with a youth. ليست له صبوة. He doesn't have what?
Assalamu
alaikum. He doesn't have any صبوة. What does صبوة mean? He doesn't have the desires to go wrong. He's a person who's young but he's upright. Allah is fascinated. And Imam Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah graded this hadith to be hasan in his kitab al-Aqidat al-Wasatiyyah. Shu'ayb al-Na'ur graded it to be hasan. Why is the case that Allah is fascinated with a youth who has no sabwa, who doesn't have that desire to do wrong? Because marhalatul shabab, when you're a youth, that time the youth is pushed by desires. He wants to go wrong. Some of the ulama, they say that this hadith, it means the youth who understands the value of time, who understands what Allah has given him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why the people who are going to gain the shade of Allah are seven types of people. And the only one that was mentioned in the hadith, سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ, which, what was it? شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ. A youth who grew up in the worship of his Lord. That doesn't happen. It's rare to find a youth with all of the things that are coming his way. He remembers Allah, and what does he come with? عِبَادَةُ رَبِّهِ. He comes with the worship of his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in another hadith, two blessings. Many people don't realize its value. And so because of that, because they don't understand its value, what happens is that they tend to not benefit from it. What are they? As-sihhat wal-farad. To have health. And to have free time. Those two are two blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many people don't understand its value. And Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah used to say to some of his students, he used to say to them, Al-Mu'asaratu Hirman. He used to say this a lot to them. Al-Mu'asaratu Hirman. What does it mean? You don't value what you have until you lose it. The person doesn't understand it. The scholars, they also say, ليلة الظلماء يفتقد البدر. The night when it's pitch dark and the moon is not out, the people realize the value of the moon. Especially countries like Africa and other countries where they don't depend on street lights. They depend on the moon. They realize the value of the moon when the moon is gone. The person values the time and health when they lose it. ولذلك the scholars, they say, الصحة تاج على رؤوس الأصحاء. Health is a crown on the head of the person who's healthy. The person who's healthy, he's got a crown on his head. لا يراه إلا ال... No one sees that crown except who? The ones who are ill. The ill ones are the only ones who can see the crown on his head. Can you see a crown on your head? Can you see a crown on your head? Can you see it? You can't. Health is like that. ولذلك, if you look at the story of the three men, the story of who? The three men, who one of them was blind, and one of them he had leprosy, and the other one he had bald head. three of them, when the angel came to them, what was the first thing that they asked for? They asked for the illness to be removed from them. Sah? The first one, he said, I am blind, I can't see, can my eyesight be brought back to me? So the first thing he wanted was what, brothers? The health to come back. He didn't ask for money, he didn't ask for anything else, he just wanted his health to come back. The second one who had leprosy, what did he say? I just want my skin to be good, I want to have a beautiful skin again. So the angel, he brought him back with the permission of Allah, a healthy skin. The third one was what? The one who was what? The one who was bald. What was it that he asked for? He asked for his hair to come back. After they asked for the illness to go away, then they said, then the angel said to them, what else do you want? They said, oh, we want risk. We want money. And this brings me into a story of that the scholars mentioned, our Mashayikh used to mention, is a man who was very rich, a very rich man. Allah gave him a lot of money, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one day he saw a poor man eating. He saw a poor man eating. And he looked at the poor man and he just wished he could have what that poor man has. What was it? He's a rich man, but there's food he can't eat. You've got this illness, don't take this. You've got this illness, don't do this. He's rich, he's got the money, but he's jealous of a poor man. Because of the health Allah gave him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it happens that a rich man is jealous and wants what's in the hands of a what? The hands of a what? A poor man. So this is the reality. نِعْمَتَانِ مَغْبُولُ فِيهِمَا كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ Two things that we have. It's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll only realize its value when, brothers? When it's once it's removed from you. لكن الكيس العاقل, the smart one, the clever one, no. He doesn't wait for things to go. He benefits it before it's gone. He realizes its value whilst he has it, and he benefits from it. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا نَعُدُّ لَهُمْ عَدَّا. What does it mean, إِنَّمَا نَعُدُّ لَهُمْ عَدَّا? Every single breath that you take, and every breath that comes out, and that which you take in, Allah says, إِنَّمَا نَعُدُّ لَهُمْ عَدَّا. We count every one of it. It's counted for you. إِنَّمَا نَعُدُّ لَهُمْ عَدَّا is an ayah that you should face in front of your eyes and always remember it. Every breath that you take, every oxygen that you take in, and it's counted. It's not that it's going and no one knows what's happening. It's written for you. And Allah is counting that for you. And then if that is the case, and it's all being documented and recorded for you, how should it not be recorded for you? How should you not be a person who benefits from it? وَلِذَلِكَ A man who was young once before and now grew old. And then when he grew old, he saw that he couldn't do what he used to do when he was young. So in a line of poetry, he said, مَالِي إِذَا جَذَبْتُهَا صَأَيْتُ أَكِبَرٌ عَلَانِي أَنْبَيْتُ لَيْتَ الشَّبَابَ لَيْتَ وَهَلْ يَنْفَعُ شَيْئًا لَيْتُ لَيْتَ الشَّبَابَ الْبُوعَ فَاشْتَرَيْتُ Ibn Aqil brings this in the Sharh Alfiyyat ibn Malik when he's talking about the shuruq of Layta and his condition. Pay attention to this. Mali, why is it? إِذَا جَذَبْتُهَا صَعِيْتُ Why is it when I pull the rope, صَعِيْتُ I go, ah, this is the old man now. Why is it that when I pull the rope, I go, ah, I never used to. مَالِي إِذَا جَذَبْتُهَا صَعِيْتُ أَكِبَرٌ عَلَانِي أَنْبَيْتُ What is it that's pushing me down and that's making me heavy right now? Later, وَهَلْ يَنْفَعُ شَيْئًا later. He goes, later, if only. But then he said to himself, he's talking back to himself, وَهَلْ يَنْفَعُ شَيْئًا later. I wish, will it benefit me now? And then he says after that, لَيْتَ شَبَابًا بُوعَ فَاشْتَرَيْتُ I wish that that مَرْحَلَةُ الشَّبَاب, that stage of being a youth can be brought back and I can, or it was sold in the market, I can go and buy it. I wish. But will that happen? It won't happen. Brothers, إِنَّ الْفُرْصَةَ إِذَا لَمْ تَنْتَهِزْهَا صَارَتْ غُصَّةً The opportunity that come in your life right now, if you don't benefit from it, there will come a time you will cry over it. And it will take away, it will be so painful. And you will wish, I see that opportunity. And a believer is the one who doesn't wait for that time to come where he regrets it. Benefit from this opportunity that you have. Don't let other things distract you. Don't let other things get in your way of seeing the value of time. مَا مَضَى فَاتْ what has taken place in the past is gone. There's no way to bring it back. والمؤمل غيب. And the thing that you're hoping for is just wishes. ولك الساعة التي أنت فيها. The only time that you own is the time that you're in. What has gone is gone. What is to come in the future is not in your hands. Allahu a'lam fi man live. No one knows that one. ولك الساعة التي أنت فيها. The only time that you possess and you have control over is the time that you're living now. The time that you're living now is what you have control over. And the believer, again, knows that. And so he benefits from that time. ولذلك the great alim, the great scholar, and Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he said these two lines of poetry. He said, اغتنم في الفراغ فضل ركوعي فعسى أن يكون موتك بغتا كم صحيح رأيت من غير سقم ذهبت نفسه الصحيحة فلتا. And Imam al-Bukhari said, اغتنم benefit في الفراغ فضل ركوعي. If you see yourself have a time where there's nothing that's happening, it's free time. What do you say? Benefit from it by doing two rak'ah. Hakada kana Bukhari rahimahullah. And Imam Bukhari was like that. Anytime he saw himself free, not doing anything, he would stand up and pray two rak'ah. Benefit from your time by doing what? Irtanim fil faraghi, the free time that you have, benefit from it by doing what? Fadla ruku'i, pray rak'ah or two. Sorry, two rak'ah. Or more if you can. فَعَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونَ مَوْتُكَ بَغْتَىٰ. Because your death can be sudden. You can just die run suddenly. Now this minute you're talking, you can die. Then look what he said after that. كَمْ صَحِيحٍ رَأَيْتَ مِنْ غَيْرِ سَقَمٍ. How many people have we seen who are healthy, who are not ill, but they passed away? Yesterday they were eating with us. They were with us and now they're gone. ذَهَبَتْ نَفْسُهُ الصَّحِيحَةُ فَلْتَ. His nafs just went suddenly. There was no illness. He didn't go to the doctors. How many people? So Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah was well known for that. Anytime he sat down, he done something, he benefited from his time, and he got some free time on his hand, he would benefit from it by what? اغتنم في الفراغ فضل ركوعي. Allah saw by time, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he only saw by it لأهميتها, because of its importance. Allah says, والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر. Allah swears by عصر. Which is time. Allah swears by, he says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَىٰ وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا تَجَلَّىٰ. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالضُّحَىٰ. All of these are time. He's swearing by it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the reason why he's swearing by it is because of its importance. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, I have not seen any good in the Sufiyya except two benefits that I took from it. Shafi'i says. Who says this? Imam Shafi'i. Imam Shafi'i, he said, I only benefited from the Sufiyya two things. Two statements of theirs was wise, and I benefited that from them, he said. And what was it? He said, الْوَقْتُ كَالسَّيْفِ إِنْ لَمْ تَقْطَعْهُ قَطَعَكَ. The first one is that time is like a sword. If you don't cut it, it will cut you. So when somebody says, I'm burning time, or I'm cutting time, or whatever, the truth of the matter is, no, it's cutting you. It's burning you. الْوَقْتُ كَالسَّيْفِ. Time is like a sword. إِن لَمْ تَقْلَعُ. If you do not cut it, it will cut you. That's the first thing I took from him, he said. I took from the Sufiyya. The second one is, نَفْسُكَ. I'm a نَفْسَكَ. You can say both ways. إِن شَغَلْتَهَا بِالْحَقِّ. If you busy it with good, then it's good. وَإِلَّا if you don't, شَغَلَتْكَ بِالْبَاطِلِ. It will preoccupy you with falsehood. Your time, brothers, if you don't busy your time with khayr and good, it will turn at you, and it will busy you, and it will destroy you. So it's one of two. Either you benefit from your time by putting a lot of khayr in there. If not, it will take benefit from you. And then next, my brothers, that we need to nurture ourselves to benefit from is like a born, newborn child. The poet, he said, وَالنَّفْسُ كَالطِّفْلِ إِن تُهْمِلْهُ شَبَّ عَلَىٰ. The nafs is like the breastfeeding of a child. The child, when it's breastfed, the mother has to stop the period of breastfeeding. She has to stop it. Allah says in the Quran, وَالْوَالِدَاتِ يُرْضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حَوْلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ لِمَنْ أَرَادَ أَن يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَةَ. 2 years, the mother has to stop the child from the breastfeeding. The nafs of the person is like that child. والنفس, the nafs is كالطفل إن تهمله شبع على حب الرضاع وإن تفطمه ينفطم. If you don't stop the child after 2 years, he will still take breast milk until the age of 10. And the nafs is like that. If you don't stop it from what it wants and what it desires, if you just don't cut it, the nafs will just want more and more and more and go on. So you have to get control over your nafs and say to it, it's over now. You're not going to get the sleep that you're asking for and the relaxation that you're looking for. I am now going to control you. You have to do this. If you don't, it will take its place and it will do what it wishes. Al-Imam Ibn Jawzi rahimahullah, he said in his kitab Sayyid al-Khatir, a powerful statement, he said, يَنْبَغِي لِلْإِنسَانِ, it is required from the person, أَنْ يَعْرِفَ شَرَفَ زَمَانِهِ, that the person knows the value of their time, وَقَدْرَ وَقْتِهِ. A lot of the people, the reason why they don't benefit from their time is because they don't know the value of time. They don't value time. If you ask people today, and then you ask them, what are you? What are you made of? All that you're made of is time that came together. 20 years ago, you weren't like this. 20 years later, you're like this. You look like this. It's time that came together that made you look like this. In your time, as Hassan al-Basri said. So it's not valuing time is what makes many people waste time. يَنْبَغِي لِلْإِنسَانِ أَنْ يَعْرِفَ شَرَفَ زَمَانِهِ وَقَدْرَ وَقْتِهِ, to know the importance of your time. And to know the time that you're living in, فَلَا يُضَيِّعُ مِنْهُ لَحْرًا, don't waste a second of it. بِغَيْرِ قُرْبَةٍ, don't waste a second except you want to get closer to Allah by doing it. And not only that, you're not just trying to do good, but you're trying to do the best. مِنَ الْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ, whether it be speech or action. Muhammad ibn Abd al-Baqir al-Bazzal, rahimahullah, he said, مَا ضَيَّعْتُ سَاعَةً مِنْ عُمْرِي فِي لَهْوِ أَوْ لَعِبٍ, I never wasted a second of my life. I never wasted it in joking or playing around. I never wasted it, he said. Who from amongst us can say that today? I did not waste a second. In my life, إلا في لهو أو لعب. I never wasted my time في لهو أو لعب, playing and joking. And sometimes you see young brothers who are playing PlayStation and they're playing this game and they're doing this. And you see sisters watching this show or watching that show. Jamaluddin al-Qasim rahimahullah, he came across a group of people playing. They were playing chess or whatever, they were playing a game. And Jamaluddin al-Qasim, when he saw them, he said, I wish time was something that could be bought and sold. I would have bought time from these people. Look how much time they've got to waste. I wish time was bought or sold so I can buy the time from these people. And a lot of people, they waste their time like that. Abu al-Wafa ibn Aqil rahimahullah, pay attention to this. He wrote a kitab called Al-Funun. Okay? He wrote a kitab called Al-Funun. This kitab Al-Funun is from the books that in Islamic world, we lost it. We don't have it, but it's 800 volumes. How many volumes was it? Some scholars now say that it's found. If it's found, inshallah ta'ala, it should be printed and published. Like in 800. Look what he said about Abu al-Wafa ibn Aqil. Abu Wafa ibn Aqil, he said, إِنِّي لَا يَحِلُّ لِي, it is not permissible for me. أَنْ أُضَيَّعَ سَعَةَ الْعُمْرِ, for me, ibn Aqil, it's not permissible for me to waste a split second. I can't waste my time. I cannot waste my time. Some of the scholars, they understood the value of time so much so, even at the times when we would waste, they wouldn't waste it. It was mentioned that in the biography of Ahmad ibn Sulaiman, Al-Bulqasi, rahimahullah, 28 years he would do this. Pay attention. What was it? يُقْرِئُ الْقِرَاءَاتِ, he would say to people, when he would read everything, and he would do what he does, when the time of the eating would come, he would say to some people, come and read on me while I'm eating. فِي حَالِ أَكْلِهِ خَوْفًا مِنْ ضَيَاعِ وَقْتِهِ فِي غَيْرِهَا, because he would not want to waste his time on looking at the food, turning over the burger. He doesn't want that. What does he want, rahimahullah? He even wants to benefit from that time. في حالة الأكل, the time of eating, he wants to benefit from that time. Ibn Taymiyyah's granddad, Abu al-Barakat, Majdil, rahimahullah, it was said that, إِذَا دَخَلَ الْخَلَاءَ لِقَضَاءِ الْحَاجَةِ, if he went to the toilet to do his call of nature, قَالَ لِبَعْضِ جُلَسَائِهِ, أَمَا قَالَ لِبَعْضِ كما قال لبعض, he would say to some people, من حوله, those who are around him, he would say to them, اقرأ في هذا الكتاب. Take this book and read it. وارفع صوتك and raise your voice. While he's in the toilet, he would give somebody a book and he would say to that individual, please read what? Please read for me so I can benefit while I do my call of nature. He wants to benefit. And he doesn't want to waste his, he doesn't want to waste his time. Ibn Humayra rahimahullah, he said, والوقت أنفس ما عنيت بحفظه وأراه أسهل ما عليك يضيع. He said, والوقت أنفس ما عنيت بحفظه. Time is the greatest thing if you benefit from and you learn its value and you look after, it's the most honorable thing, wallah. وأراه, and some copies say وأراه. If you say وأراه, it means أي أظن. وأراه, it means أي وأعلم. What does it mean? I know many of the people won't benefit from it. They waste it, sahih. Time is the most valuable thing that Allah gave us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and many will not benefit from it. Al-Imam ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah, he actually mentioned that time is more even valuable than, or wasting time and destroying time or losing time is much worse than losing a loved one. Ibn al-Jawz, Ibn al-Qayyim says, إِضَاعَةُ الْوَقْتِ أَشَدُّ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ. Wasting time and losing that time that went by is worse than death. Why? لِأَنَّ إِضَاعَةِ الْوَقْتِ لِأَنَّ إِضَاعَةَ الْوَقْتِ تَقْطَعُكَ عَنِ اللَّهِ وَالدَّارِ الْآخِرَةِ. Because if you waste time, it will disconnect you from Allah and the Day of Judgment. وَالْمَوْتُ, as for death, what would it do? يَقْطَعُكَ عَنِ الدُّنْيَا وَأَهْلِهَا. But if you die, all it will disconnect you from is your family and the people of the dunya. But like in wasting time will disconnect you from Allah the hereafter and the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I now went to India and I was with some of the scholars, I saw that some of them would even benefit from the times when the hadith would be read. When we read the hadith of Bukhari, and we read the hadith of Kutub Sita, even the times when they are listening to you, they will still do their adhkar. They would have wasted it. And this is something that was mentioned by Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah. It was said about him that he would do the Majlisul Imla. Majlisul Imla is the gathering of dictating the hadiths. He would dictate the hadiths to the people. And when he dictates the hadith, because there's no microphone, another person would have to have read it out loud, another person would. And Imam Ahmad, they said roughly 30,000 people would come to his halaqah. So you can imagine how long that's going to take for it to come back to him again. In that time, Ahmad, rahimahullah, he would do his dhikr. Until it came back to him to mention the next hadith. And to mention the next hadith. I read in the tarjama of Siddiq Hassan Khan when I was in Banaris, Jami' al-Salafiyya in Banaris, the tarjama of Imam Siddiq Hassan Khan, rahimahullah, al-Qannawji. Do you know Siddiq Hassan Khan? Do you guys know him? Siddiq Hassan Khan is from the scholars of India, one of the prominent scholars of India. Rahimahullah, rahmatan wasa'a. I read in his biography, rahimahullah, that he mentions that when Siddiq Hassan Khan went to Hajj, there was not a plane that he took a boat. His rihla, his journey was 8 months. What did he do in that time? How did he benefit from it? He, rahimahullah, what he did was, he took the kitab As-Sarib al-Mukki fi al-Raddi al-Sukki ibn Abdul Hadi, rahimahullah, and he copied the whole book with his own hand. He rewritten. Because there's no publishing, there's no printing houses where you get a book, you print it out, and you go. If somebody had a book, Bukhari, for example, or they had Sahih Muslim, you would say, give me your copy. And you take a pen and paper and you copy everything from it. That's how everybody used to do it. So Siddiq Hassan Khan, he prepared this opportunity to do it when? On his journey to Mecca. So he took the kitab As-Sarib al-Mukki fi al-Raddi al-Sukki and he wrote it, all of it, with his own hand. And look what he said after that. He said, وَلَمْ أُضَيِّعْ زَمَرَ رُقُوبِي الْبَحْرَ عَبَثًا. I did not waste my time whilst I was on the boat for a split second, I didn't waste it. Every minute of writing the book. Rahimahullah ta'ala. When Siddiq Hassan Khan, they say he He used to work for a princess. He was working for a princess for 17 years. Who? Sadiq? Sadiq Hasan Khan. He used to work for a princess for 17 years, and she saw his honesty and his truthfulness and his uprightness and his steadfastness. She was amazed with it, with him. And her husband died. So the people around her, they said to her, listen, you have to get married because you can't run this whole empire yourself. Your husband was helping you before. You can't. Then what you need to do is marry somebody. So she said, who? They said, Siddiq Hasan Khan. Why don't you marry him? Listen to this. So the princess came to Siddiq Hasan Khan and she offered herself. In the biography, he mentions in his book, he goes, I didn't want her. Because he said, my nahma, my drive was for knowledge of ilm. I loved knowledge and I was into seeking knowledge and gaining knowledge. But because I saw good in this, he said, I went forward with it. And as soon as Siddiq Hasan Khan, she married him, she gave him a portion of land to control. And she placed a lot of things into his hands. And so what did he do, alayhi rahmatullah? You remember the hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As? Ni'ma al-rajul al-salih, ni'ma mal al-rajul al-salih, li-rajul al-salih. The Prophet said, what a good wealth of a righteous man. A righteous man's wealth is honorable. Siddiq Hasan Khan straight away, he called Hussein ibn Hassan al-Ansari, rahimahullah. And Nadir Hussein al-Din, not Nadir, Muhammad Bashir al-Sihsawani, rahimahullah. And the ulama of India, he called them all, and he built a publishing house with the money that he had, and he said, all of you need to rewrite these books. And he made them by Fath al-Bari. Kitab al-Tawheed by Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was first published in India. Kitab al-Tawheed was first published in India with the supervision of Siddiq Hasan Khan al-Qannauji rahimahullah. He employed all of the scholars of ilm of India and he said, rewrite this. Are we all together, brothers? And India was ahead of every country when it came to publishing books. Even now, if you go to Hyderabad, Deccan, and you go to the Darul Ma'arif al-Uthmaniyya, Darul Ma'arif al-Uthmaniyya by in India, in India, Hyderabad, where Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Mu'allimi used to be. Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Mu'allimi was there. Are we all together, brothers? I spoke about that in more detail in my benefits. Abdul Rahman Yahya al-Mu'allimi, he was in Hyderabad, and he had a publishing house called Dar al-Ma'arif al-Uthmaniyya, where he used to work, in India. And he's from Yemen originally. Where is he from? He's originally from Yemen. So he resided in, until today that Maktaba is still there with manuscripts, books. The best Taba'a of Fathul Bari and Sahih Bukhari today is Taba'a al-Bawla al-Amiriyya by Siddiq Hasan Khan. Rahimahullah. Ala kulli hal, the point is, this man, he exerted every single effort and energy that he had, alayhi rahmatullah, jazakallah khairan. Every effort that he had, he benefited from every minute and every second. And wallahi, brothers, I realized that the people you see that pass you, and the people that you see go beyond your station and have passed you, have gone way ahead of you, are people who exerted time and effort when you wasn't. At a time you chose to sleep, at a time that you chose to laugh, at a time that you chose to enjoy yourself, they chose not. And that's where they passed you. And every single biography I read in the kitab of Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi, Sir Alam al-Nubala, wallahi, I realized if I could say in this book, Sir Alam al-Nubala, by Imam Al-Dhahabi, and the biography of the great scholars, by Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj, Abu Bishr al-Ataki, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, Qatad ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi, and Ikrimah, Mawla Abdullah ibn Abbas. And other than them, from the ulama of hadith, I realized one thing that they passed everybody. And that was, they valued their time. They knew the importance of their time. I was doing Umrah I was coming to do Umrah, so I came from Dil Hulaifa, which is the miqat of the people of Medina. And I was there, I put my ihram on, the brother that was going to take me, I went into the car with him, and we're making our way to Medina. And I made a phone call to Sheikh Al-Allama, Muhammad Ali Adim in Ethiopia. I called the Sheikh and I said, Sheikh Muhammad Ali, I'm coming to Mecca. I want to see you. I have questions to ask you. And he said, Abdul Rahman, ma'indi waqt. Abdurrahman, I have no time. It's true. He doesn't have time. Because if he gives time to me, there's another one like me who has a question. And another one has another question. And is he going to bring out the works that he brings out? Yeah, brothers. No, wallahi. Anyone who goes to Riyadh and meets Sheikh Fawzan, مثلاً, and goes to Darul Iftah, where he sits sometimes, and you walk into the office, and you knock the door, and you sit, and you see him. Sometimes you catch him by himself, Sheikh Fawzan, and you go to him, and you ask him a question. The Sheikh will say to you, hey, when you ask the question, you have another question. No. Hey, inshallah, barakallah. You ask the questions, 4 or 5 questions, and then you have to go. You're not just going to sit there and watch him. And he doesn't want you to do that. Because his time means a lot to him. And the reason is because they value their time. Their time means a lot to them. And because we've chosen not to, the production level of our life is very weak. So we come into this world and we leave it, and guess what we've left behind? Our feces, our body, and that's it. And our existence and our presence is of no value. Wallahi. Sahih. If you had come and if you didn't come, it's the same. Rather, if you didn't come, it would have been better, some of us, including me. But these people, they came and they changed it. Al-Imam al-Nawawi, do you know how old he was when he died? Yeah? Al-Imam al-Nawawi was in his 40s. Do you know the great Imam whose madhab today is followed, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i? Do you know how old he was when he died? Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was only 54 years. 54 years. Rahimahullah. That is young. Okay? So how did he do it? 54 years. He's got one of the largest amount of madhab that's followed today. And where did he get all of that knowledge from? And how did he do all of that? Are you with me, brothers? Because, brothers, he benefited from his time. And he was consistent upon it. اطلب ولا تضجر من مطلب فافة الطالب أن يضجر أما ترى الماء بتكراره في الصخرة الصماء قد أثرى. He was consistent. He never gave up. He benefited from his time. Brothers, be consistent in learning and be continuous. أما ترى الماء. Do you not see the water? Its consistency and its continuation, it can actually affect a rock. The water, it hits the rock and it then hits the rock again. And then it hits the rock again. And as time goes on, years, maybe 3-4 years, what will it do to the rock? It'll make a hole inside that rock. This is water. Go through the rock. But how did he do it? Allahu Akbar. Consistency and continuation. And he didn't give up. So if you do the same, brothers, you can go through every science and every knowledge, you can go through it. That you thought to yourself was actually hard. And that you couldn't make it through. There was a young boy who came to his teacher and he said, Sheikh, I want to make it to Fajr, I want to play at the front line. Every time I come to Fajr, he said, it's full. He's a young boy. The teacher said to him, well, you have to come earlier than the rest of the people. So the young boy told his mom, tomorrow morning I want to make it to the masjid early. Please wake me up. So she woke him up very, very early. And so when she woke him up very early, he made his way to the what? To the masjid. The masjid was locked. He came too early. So they saw a little hole inside the masjid. He saw a little hole inside the masjid. So he went in. And when he went in, on the other side, it was a very sharp object sticking upwards. So he got his leg into it and he bled. But then he ran to the front row and he sat down. And he sat there. The Mu'adhin came and he done the adhan and the salah was prayed. And when they turned around, the face was bleeding. The blood, it was a puddle. So the teacher said to him, what is it that happened to you? And he said to him, he told him the story. And he said, Uktub ya bunayya, my son, write this benefit I'm going to tell you. He said, my son, write what I'm going to tell you. And he said, دَبِبْتَ لِلْمَجْدِ وَالسَّاعُونَ قَدْ بَلَغُوا جَهْدَ النُّفُوسِ وَأَلْقَوْ دُونَهُ الْأُزُرَى وَكَابِدِ الْمَجْدَ حَتَّى مَلَّ أَكْتَرُهُمْ وَعَانِقِ الْمَجْدَ مَنْ أَوْفَى وَمَنْ صَبَرَ لا تحسبن المجد تمرا انت اكله لن تبلغ المجد حتى تلعق الصمغ. So right, my son, the benefit I'm going to give you. This situation that you're in right now, you're bleeding, your puddle that you're going through. He said, it comes with what you were looking for. You were looking for honor. You were looking for virtue. You were looking to attain something. It doesn't just come. لا تحسبن المجد تمرا انت اكله. Don't think honor and station and being an imam and an allama is just something you take off a tree like that and it's just easy. لن تبلغ المجد. والله you're never gonna receive honor and gain the station that you're looking for حتى تلعق الصبر, unless you endure a lot of patience and hardship and you exert a lot of effort in it. So brothers, wallahi, I advise you all, value your time, benefit from your time, study, learn, and be of value. I saw some scholars, wallahi, some of them are young, mashallah, and they memorize books of hadith. I saw some of them who were old in age, and they benefited from their life. One of the things that shocked me was, some of the scholars, they wake up for Fajr. One of the mashayikh that I met there, he wakes up in the morning. In the morning when he wakes up, he sits there and he's doing shuruh of the six books of Sunnah books. Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i. And so he's sitting there. He's author. He comes Fajr and he leaves Isha. So I said, Sheikh, and so when he finishes a book and his explanation, he gets a rope and he ties the notes on it and he puts it on top of the shelf. I said, Sheikh, are you printing it? Are you sending it off to anyone? Are you sending it to publishing house? What are you doing with all of these notes? And he said, I just write it and I put it there. Allah brings it into somebody's hand. Good. They get it. That's good. It'll be printed. If not, then no problem. I said, can you give me copies? He said, there it is. Take a picture of it if you want. It's shocking. Some of these scholars that you see, they don't have phones. Some of them, even if they do have phones, they don't even know how to use it properly. So they're getting their part, you put the ear on, upside down. So you have to correct it. And these people know the Qutb al-Hadith. They know the Riwayat. They know the Asaneed. They know the Turuq. It was narrated that Imam Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti. You all know Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, right? Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti was an Allama. And if somebody can be said about this particular time of that we're living in, he's reached a daraja of could be called a mujtahid, it would be him. Muhammad Amin Shaqiqi, he memorized dictionaries, the Arabic dictionary, Lisan al-Arab, haf'ul he knew by heart. And Imam Muhammad Amin Shaqiqi, he knew off by heart, memorized the dictionary. Rahimahullah. That man whose memory is like that, Muhammad Amin Shaqiqi never took a note to a dars. They would come and he would do tafsir from the top of his head. And he would leave. That man with that hifd and that memory, his students are Bakr al-Huzayn and the likes of them. Abdul Aziz al-Baz is a student of Muhammad Amin al-Shaqiqi. But they said when he went to the shop and he wanted to buy something, he didn't know the difference between the money. So he put all of his hand in his pocket, all of the money that would come out, and would say to the person in the shop, take what's yours, I don't know this. You see, brothers? And the person would put their hand in and take whatever was theirs, and they would leave what wasn't theirs. Because the value of the dunya is nothing to them. The poet, he said, وَالْجُوعُ يُطْرَضُ بِالرَّغِيفِ الْيَابِسِ فَعَلَى مَا تَكْثُرُ حَسْرَتِي وَوَسَاوِسِي. Really, if you think about it, hunger can be removed with what? What can hunger be removed with? A dry bread. A dry bread can remove the hunger. فَعَلَى مَا تَكْثُرُ حَسْرَتِي وَوَسَاوِسِي. So why are you stressed about the job that you're going to get tomorrow? And what position are you going to be? Are you going to be risen? Are they going to make you the project manager? Are you going to be the CEO of the company? The truth of the matter is that your hunger can be removed with a dry bread. So he doesn't value, they don't value the dunya. And that's what you see, wallahi, when you travel and you see these ulama, the dunya that people are stressed about and that they're worried about. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith of Miqdam ibn Ma'dika, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, ma mala ibn Adam wa'a'an, that the children of Adam do not fill a vessel worse than what? Than their stomach. Bihasbi ibn Adam luqaymatun yuqimnu sulbahu. Enough for the children of Adam is some, just a little bit of food that you can straighten your back. That's enough for you. That's all you need, right? That's the whole dunya that you're in, that's all you need. But we are different. And today, subhanAllah, I was with Sheikh Khalid Mushaykh. I was with him, and we were in a hotel one that day. And when he came out, I said to the Sheikh, well, one of the things that shocked me about the Sheikh was his zuhd, how steady he is, how he just turned away from the dunya. SubhanAllah, guess what? In the hotel, he takes the mattress off the bed, he puts on the floor, and he sleeps on the floor. Wallahi, I saw that. He takes the mattress off the bed and he puts it on the floor and he sleeps on the floor. So I said to him, Sheikh, Allah, 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 Allah. I said to the Sheikh, I was astonished with his fiqh and his nazar of hadith and his istinbatat that was made. And how he knew ghazw al-aqwal, how he can be the qawl to the imam who believed that madhab. And he won't do la yatala'atham. It's all there on the tip of his tongue. And I said to him, Shaykh, how do you learn this fiqh like this? Speed, fast. I'm slow, personally. And he goes to me, ijtihad. You just have to put exact effort in there. And I remember the line of poetry. تمنيت أن تكون فقيها مناظرا بغير عناء والجنون فنون. تمنيت, you wish to be a faqih, a jurist. That's what you want to be. You want to be a faqih, a jurist, مناظرا, who can debate and eloquent in his speech. بغير عناء, but you do not want to exert every effort in that. والجنون فنون. And insanity comes in different ways. That's a form of insanity. To want to be a faqih, and a person who's munadir, can debate, eloquent, is hujjah, is strong, bighayri ana'in, without exerting any effort, that's a form of insanity. Wal-jununu funun. The best of speech is maqalla, wadaq. The best speech is that which is short and is to the point. So inshallah, I'll conclude there bi'idhni ilahi kareem. Anything which I have said that was wrong, incorrect, false or mistake is from me, shaytan, and Allah, and the messenger are free from it. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.